So welcome everyone to the Health Holland webinar on the PPP allowance. My name is Jochem Christiaanse and I am the program coordinator of the PPP allowance. So this webinar will consist of two parts. Firstly, the director of Health Holland, Nico van Meteren, he will give a presentation about mission-driven innovation and the knowledge and innovation infrastructure. And secondly, I will highlight the multiple ways that how we at Health Holland allocate the PPP allowance and talk a little bit more in depth about our match call procedure. So please do also note that this webinar will be recorded and placed on the website afterwards. So you can rewatch it and find the slides with all the information. So without further ado, Nico, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Jochem. Welcome, everybody. My name is Nico van Meteren. I'm the executive director of the Bureau of the Top Sector Life Science and Health. And a part of that, I'm a professor at the Erasmus Medical Center from out of the Department of Anesthesiology. Well, I will take you along with what we have established recent one and a half year on the mission-driven top sector and innovation policy of this demissioner cabinet. What we have is a 1+1+1 is no longer more than 3, 4, or 5. But what is established the last 1.5 years is to continue to cooperate on 4 missions and 1 central mission. And that's about the health and care sector. But what we have is a complete mission-driven policy in which there are 4 challenges. One is on energy transition and sustainability. The other one is on agriculture, food, and water. The third one is about safety. And the fourth one, of course, is, and that's what we're here for, is on the health and care sector. So these are the 4 themes, societal themes, where this cabinet invests in per year, approximately 5 billion euros per year. And these have 25 missions, and these 25 missions have to be accomplished within 10 or 20 years to have Holland future chefy for the rest of the century. That's at least what we hope. Next slide, please. We have, though, to discontinue what we have done before. We really have to change. Not just society has to change, and especially those that are, for instance, not healthy, but especially those that are well educated in the academic staff, in companies. We, from the top notch levels, we have to change and de-implement what we have done before. Next slide. The missions for health and care are the following ones. Sorry that these are not in English, but I will take you through along with these. The central missions is all about having people all in the Netherlands in 2040 living at least 5 years longer, but not just longer. They should live 5 years longer in good health. And the most intriguing part of this mission is how can we establish that 30% of the health inequalities have been vanished. And that's a mission that has not been accomplished before, not in the Netherlands and not everywhere around. And this has all to be settled in 2040. Within these missions, there are 4 missions. Within this central mission, there are 4 missions. One concerning lifestyle and life context. One about the care at the right spot. The other one is about people with chronic diseases, and the fourth is a special chronic disease, of course, is people with dementia. What is paramount that the lifestyle and life surroundings are changing for the better in 2030. The other thing is to have 50% of what is now provided as care in the intramural context has to shift towards the extramural context. People with chronic disease in this perspective have to be able and supported to take part of society more than they do now, approximately 25% more, and especially people with dementia and their, let's say, informal care system have to experience a better quality of life all in 2030. So what we have to establish in 2030s are these four missions to be successful on the central mission in 2040. Next slide, please. Next slide. So it is all about plus 5, minus 30. That is the mantra I want you to have in your mind at the end of this meeting. It's all about plus 5, minus 30. Next slide. What is especially paramount is that people have to be part of society, to participate in society. And this is an example which is very intriguing and also interesting. This is Robin. Robin is a icon of the top sector, and he has developed a pancreas, an artificial pancreas, set up a company in Reda, and he is himself is a diabetic patient, and he serves with this apparatus his own health. But this is not just about Robin and his health. Here we see what has to really be established. This apparatus is not just providing health, but it's also providing good quality of combined efforts of, in this respect, this lady and her husband. The lady has diabetes mellitus for years and years and has suffered a lot of hypos through the years. And here you see that that this lady isn't just doing self-management, but is really involved in shared management of the disease in the back office here at their home. And in the front office, they experience the support of this apparatus, not just for health, but also for becoming member of society again. Before they had this apparatus for the lady, they were sort of a Siamese twin. They couldn't separate, never, because she had several hypos during the day. And they were sort of clinged to each other. But nowadays, due to this apparatus, they are capable of going on their own, alone. And she is actually, nowadays, when they have fundamental trust in the apparatus and in the the settlement of the apparatus, they have now decided she can go on her own, trusting on the apparatus and trusting on technology. So this is what we really want. We want technology and therapy for the future, not just serving health, but serving also to be part of society and to participate as a human being up to your limits and up to your wishes. Next slide. So these four missions and the central mission I presented before are one and the same. That's why they are pictured by Petruskas. What we want and what we are doing now is having all the knowledge and innovation institutes participate on the topics of these five missions into society. we draw them into society. And what is the, let's say, the fundamental approach here, next slide, is this. Let's find out what it is really. It is not just about the individual citizen and his self-management and within his context, but all the more it is about the future is about not just self-management, but especially management of health and participating together in neighborhoods and in cities. And this is all about facilitating the informal support and the individual in cities and municipality. And it's all about the talent used in self-management in combination with joint management in the life context. And if talent fails short, then we try to establish to draw in technology. And what is more, technology, whenever it's needed, comes with formal support from therapy. And this, you have to understand, is the backbone of our whole strategy for the next 10 years in order to get the full impact within 2040, as I showed you on the hand by hand of the five missions. Why is that so important? Nowadays, next slide, we have the informal support of 3.5 million people of age that will expand to approximately 5 million people. And these are highly active, well-educated people in their pension age, and they are still participating in society. And these are providing, for instance, lots of care towards each other and towards the rest of their neighborhood and society. And what we want is that this informal and formal support join their forces in society. And when their force and talent fail short, they bring in technology, which is not just from the formal support, but is really intermingling between the informal and formal support. And if really talent and technology fail short, then we provide from out of the formal support therapy. You have to understand, this is the paramount backbone for the transition of the healthcare system in the Netherlands, but also abroad. Next slide. If we want to establish this, we have to have input and activities. And these input, which I told you in the beginning, is about approximately 5 billion euros for the 4 societal challenge, of which is 1 billion euros per year for research and development innovation activities. And that is quite in control of us, our input and our activities. And of course, also our output, let's say new products, new services, as well as IPs or publications, that is quite near to us, our output. Here, the sphere of control is high. But if you really want to establish outcome with other stakeholders and impact with a lot of stakeholders and the essential target groups of your input and activities and output, we have to manage to have all stakeholders and partners on board of the system and also on board of these input activities and especially the output. So you have to combine your effort, not just within the context of your public-private partnership, but you really have to look forward to what is to be established and how can you establish it, not just within the realm of the output, but really focusing on impact on the really on the short distance. Next slide. Therefore, we have put forward a national knowledge and innovation infrastructure. First of all, we had 9 and in essential 10 top sectors that were somehow working on their own. But after 2017, we combined our efforts. Next slide. And that's combining our efforts in public-private partnerships. Lots of these public-private partnerships were established during the years, and this was, first of all, the knowledge and innovation infrastructure, which was established 2017, 2018. But now we have added our key enabling technologies, let's say the beta influences of academia. And we have set out a new line of transferring society and especially health and care that is called GROS. And GROS stands for the anagram of Zorg, which is the Dutch word for health. It's just to show you that this initiative all over this complete knowledge and innovation infrastructure is really trying to transfer not anymore the Z in Dutch of ziekte en zorg up front in this anagram, but especially the G of gezondheid en gedrag in front, or behavior and health in front in the letters in this anagram. Apart from this more beta focused infrastructure, we have thus added the transition participation of all kind of other academic expert, and that was all about the key enabling methodologies, so the alpha and gamma colleagues of the knowledge and innovation infrastructure. And this is the complete infrastructure within this infrastructure. Still the public-private partnerships and projects are involved, but they have to serve within the next decades to transfer the societal themes, health and care, and be guided by the missions and the central missions, which I showed you in the start of this lecture. Next slide. It seems like a mission impossible to invest in health and to invest in participation and to be of importance in society, but we can do it. It is not a mission impossible, we have shown. It is just like Pippi Longstocking's already said, and probably you are familiar with this little girl. Her philosophy is, it is not impossible, I've never done it, so I'll manage. I hope you have some insight in what the establishment should be within 10 or 20 years, and that you have also find common pathways to have investments from all sorts of subsidies parties, which I showed you 1.1 billion euros per year. And public-private partnership is the cornerstone of this transition for the next years. You will be invited by my colleagues now to have somewhat more knowledge of the transferring of the PPP match call and the regulations and finance in that. But please be invited to really read the papers on this policy and to really get it not just in your heart, but also in your head and your hands, to really provide those projects that will really steer and gear and fuel these 5 missions. Lots and lots of success.
Well, thank you, Nico, for this presentation. So as previously announced and as announced by Nico just now, we will now continue with the different options on applying for PPP allowance. So first, I want to start with this PPP alliance. So one of the instruments that we use to stimulate these PPPs that Nico was talking about is the PPP allowance. In short, the PPP allowance regulation means that every privately invested euro in public-private partnerships is rewarded by the Dutch government with 30 cents to the top sector of life science and health. So how does Health Holland use this PPP allowance to stimulate new collaborative projects? So at the top sector life sciences and health, a great part of the generated PPP allowance becomes available for the organization that has generated this PPP allowance by use of the grondslag. So it is returned to the grondslag submitter, as you can see here. And this is returned in a few different ways. So the first way this is returned is that the PPP allowance has been allocated to multiple organizations by means of a temporary reservation. By use of this reservation, that each individual organization can select one or more projects depending on the amount of this reserved PPP allowance. And this can be submitted through our match call. This match call has two deadlines per year, one in March and one in October. During this match call, an independent evaluation committee assesses the proposals and issues an advice to our board of Health Holland. And our board then decides if the PPP allowance is awarded or not. After this decision of the board, so basically within 10 weeks after the deadline, the applicants will then be informed about the decision of our board. I will, however, come back to the specific match call regulations later on in this webinar. So another way that we at Health Holland allocate this PPP allowance is through an allocation to six different research organizations that you can see right over here. These research organizations, they do not have to submit their proposals via the match call procedure. Please also note that in addition to these six research organizations, the Radboud UMC, the Maastricht UMC, and the ACTA, they will probably also operate through this allocation starting in October 2021. But these organizations, they have the privilege to allocate their PPP allowance themselves to individual projects. So the majority of these organizations, they organize their own internal match call. And if you would like to know more about their internal procedure or of one of these organizations, please contact the internal PPP contact person. And if you don't know who that is, you can ask us at Health Holland who this person is, and we can provide you with the contact information. So we have some other PPP allowance that we allocate to the members of the Samenwerkende Gezondheidsfondsen or the Association of the Dutch Health Foundations. Examples of these members are the Dutch Heart Foundation or the Dutch Kidney Foundation. And because since these organizations, they also invest in research and development, their financial contribution to R&D projects also generates some PPP allowance. And a few of part of these SGF members, they use their PPP allowance through the same allocation route as some of these knowledge institutes. And the other part of the SGF members, they use the PPP allowance through a reservation. So basically the same as this temporary reservation, but a little bit different because they have their own evaluation board. So they select and assess the proposals themselves. And together with a positive recommendation from their scientific board, they submit the proposal via this match call procedure as well to Health Holland. And then our board, they decide if the PPP allowance is awarded to a project. So we still have a little bit PPP allowance left. And so there's the rest of this PPP allowance. We allocate those to strategic projects and we use them for thematic calls. So the examples of some strategic projects are RegMed XB Consortium and Oncode Institute. And an example of a thematic call was that last year we performed a COVID call. So we also partner with other funders like Zonnewey and NWO to set up some of these thematic calls as well. But what if an organization that has not submitted any grondslag previously and has therefore not generated any PPP allowance? Can this organization, or you, if you're from that organization, can you still apply for any PPP allowance? And the answer to this is yes, you can do that. But then the company or the companies that are involved in your consortium, they will have to make a substantial in-cash contribution, because 30% of this in-cash contribution will generate PPP allowance. I will give a small example of this later on. These PPP allowance proposals, they can be submitted via the match call as well. Please also note that consortia from the research organizations which allocate their PPP allowance in the internal procedure are also eligible for this extra option of generating PPP allowance, but they will have to submit through the match call, so not through their internal call. However, I also recommend to watch our PPP allowance animation. You can find it on our website. And in this animation, our match call procedure is clearly explained again. So now we continue on with an overview of the match call, which I have mentioned several times already. I would like to start with this. If you are thinking about writing a proposal, I would urge you to always start with making contact with either us at Health Holland or the PPP contact of your organization about the different funding opportunities. And that way we can help you and steer you in the right direction. Secondly, the proposals that you are writing up, they have to comply with multiple conditions. These conditions are the following. So first one is that the project covers either fundamental research, industrial research, or experimental development, or a combination of one of these types of research. The second condition is that the research fits within the societal challenges that Nico was talking about earlier on, and also fits within one or more of the missions of this knowledge and innovation agenda, and has a clear connection to the key technologies and the key methodologies. If you want to know more, you can about this documents. You can find them on our website, and you can also look back in the webinar afterwards. Another condition is that the consortium consists of at least one for-profit enterprise and at least one research organization. It doesn't have to be limited to either these two. You can have more organizations in your consortium, but you have to at least one for-profit and one research organization. The main applicant has to be located in the Netherlands. Also, again, you can work with organizations from outside of the Netherlands, but the main applicant has to be Dutch. So besides a possible cash contribution, all consortium partners should make an in-kind contribution. So we interpreted that at least all consortium partners, they incur payroll costs. And last but not least is that the project may have a maximum duration of 4 years. So in the previous slide, I mentioned three research categories. But what is the difference between these three research categories? So I will go over them right now. So the first one is the fundamental research. This covers experimental work to acquire new knowledge of the underlying foundations, so without any direct commercial application in view. The second type of research is the industrial research. This is planned research that aim at the acquisition of new knowledge, but for developing new projects and services. And the third type of research is experimental development. That is using the existing knowledge and skills that has been acquired with other type of research with the aim of developing new or improved products. So how does this type of research come into play in generating your PPP allowance? So for each research category, different percentages of PPP allowance can be deployed and different percentages of co-funding are applicable. So as you can see from this table, 75% of the of your project can be funded with PPP allowance in the case of fundamental research. And in the case of industrial research, this is 50%. And in the case of experimental development, this is 25%. Also, enterprises must contribute at least 15% of the total project costs in the case of fundamental research, at least 30% in the case of industrial research, and at least 45% in the case of experimental development. For these enterprises, please note this is for-profit and non-profit enterprises. I will go over it in a few moments. But we have made a distinction between large enterprises and SMEs. The contribution of these SMEs, they may be fully in kind, but in the case of large enterprises, at least 2/3 of the required minimum conditions, so the required minimum 50%, minimum 30, or minimum 45, at least 2/3 of that part must consist of a cash contribution. And with a cash contribution, we mean that the money that is transferred from the company's bank account to the bank account of the research organization. So let's give an example of one of these calculations. So let's take some UMC, and they have a reservation of 250,000 euros to co-fund new collaborative projects. So if this new project consists of fundamental research only, then it is possible to fund up to 75% of the total project cost with PPP allowance. So then the total cost of this project must be at least 333,000 euros. And if you compare this with either industrial research, then your project cost has to be at least 500,000 euros. So 50% of that is the 250,000. And the same for experimental development, it has to be at least 1 million euros, 25%, 250,000. So let's also give an example of a project which generates their own PPP allowance, so without the grondslag. So if you take a total example of total project budget of 1 million euros, and the company contributes 500,000 euros in cash towards this project. So then 30% of the in cash of the company can be applied for. So this relates to 150,000 euros of PPP allowance that can be generated through this in cash contribution of the company. And then the rest of the budget will be made up of in-kind contributions of the company and the knowledge institute. So due to the COVID situation, we wanted it to be easier for SMEs and other enterprises to participate in public-private partnerships. And therefore we devised some new regulations for 2021. So in the previous years, the minimum matching of enterprises could only be provided by for the for-profit enterprises, so the either the 15%, the 30%, or the 45%. But this year, other enterprises may also contribute to this minimum matching requirement. These enterprises, they are defined as each unit that is irrespective of its legal form or manner of funding that carries out an economic activity. Another change in 2021 is that Dutch enterprises may this year fund more of their project costs with PPP allowance. So for fundamental and industrial research, they are allowed to fund up to 50% of their cost with PPP allowance. For experimental development, this will still remain the 25% that it was last year. So this is a little bit more of money that they can fund with the fundamental and industrial research. So another thing that Health Holland has incorporated in the match call is that we believe it is vital to analyze the actual impact and possibilities for implementations of the innovations at an early stage. So in other words, while they are still in the research and development phase. And for that reason, we started working together with Health Innovation Netherlands, or HINL. And at an early stage, so what do they do? At an early stage, HINL brings together the relevant parties that play a crucial role in the either the development, evaluation, the use, decision-making and reimbursement processes so that the innovators, they are facilitated on their road to success. And they do this by a meeting, and such a meeting is called a round table. So if your consortium has the intention to either to apply for CE marking during the project period or within 2 years after the project, so then we urge you to contact HINL, and they will provide you then with an independent review, identify critical stakeholders, and will set up one of those roundtable discussions to provide innovation guidance. I would like to urge you also to please contact them before submitting your application, no later than 3 weeks in advance to the match call deadline. And if you would like to have some more information about INL and their value for your consortium, we would like you to refer to our match call regulation document that you can find on our website. I would like to end with the deadlines of the match call. So the match call deadlines this year will be on March 17.
Sorry, Jochem's internet has a little bug, but he will be back in a short minute.
Yeah, I'm back.
So I will go over this slide again. So the deadlines of this year will be on March 17 and October 6th. So if there are any questions regarding your specific application, you can make an appointment with us on either 17 and 24 February for the match call deadline of March, and 8 and September, 15 September, for the deadline in October. And you can just do this by sending an email to this email address, tki@healthholland.com. So now I would like to go over to any remaining questions that have not already been answered in the chat. And I would like to ask you to raise your hand by the raise hand function, and then you will be unmuted by, or asked to be unmuted by my colleague. Je kan ook een vraag stellen.
Nee. Klaske, can you ask your question that you asked in the chat, maybe?
Yes, it was not completely clear to me what these new entities were that could enter that had an economic profit. So I thought maybe if you give some examples, then it becomes more clear to me.
So it's that's a good question. It's basically every enterprise that has any economic activity. So you can think that's also Ambi SMEs or more like hospitals that have a non-profit ID behind it.
Okay.
So more those kind of organizations that we want to incorporate more in these consortiums as well.
Okay, and the hospital, can that then also be in kind, or should it also be cash?
It can also be in kind if it's still an SME or classified as an SME.
Okay.
Anneliene Jonker, can you unmute yourself and ask your question?
Yes. I have actually a very quick question about any of those non-entities. Can a part of them, of that company delivering the in-kind of in-cash contribution, can that be a foreign company?
No, because foreign companies are not allowed to receive PPP allowance. So only Dutch enterprises are allowed to receive PPP allowance. Does this answer your question?
Yes.
Yeti van Ginkel, can you ask your question?
Yeah, thank you. We have in our consortium multiple institutes that how do you say, beheren that have their own grondslag, like Erasmus MC, Amsterdam UMC. We always struggle a bit how we can use the grondslag when we work together. Do we have to split it up in one project per entity, or is there actually a way to apply as a consortium and use this grondslag?
So you want to use multiple grondslag PPP allowance parts in one consortium? That's your question?
Well, yeah, basically we don't care where it's coming from, of course, but we have organizations that do have their own grondslag within the consortium.
Yep.
Should we apply through these separate organizations, or how does it work?
So that is dependent on all of the parties that are in the consortium, but I would urge you to make an appointment with us so we can discuss this more in private, I think, because this is all dependent on all the parties and what is the best possible way for you to go. So you can go either through an internal call of one of these organizations or go via the match call, but this is all dependent, very specific on your consortium. So please set up an appointment with us so we can discuss this more in detail.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah.
Let's see, Martin de Bors, you have asked a question in the chat. Can you ask them now to Jochem?
Yeah, I had the same question actually related to several UMCs within a consortium. So I think the same applies to me.
Okay, yeah, same answer then.
Thanks.
Lilian Jonker, you have ask a question. Do you have one more?
Sorry, I will lower my hand.
Ah, okay. Are there any more questions?
Yeah, I'm Gijs Gelijns. I'm with IKNL. And I wonder if we have a grondslag or if we follow on a different basis for this financing scheme. What's the best way to find out?
You can send us an email and we can help you with also, maybe if you do not have it yet, trying to apply for it. But also, we have a list of everyone that gets this. So you can just send an email to us and we'll help you.
Thanks.
Gijs, I think you're talking about your toegepaste oncologie call, right?
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah, that went through the intention to. It's an extra pathway that's of our own subsidy part, so we will have contact with you. It's kind of special.
Okay.
Yeah, this is part of one of those thematic calls.
Yeah.
This keeps us sharp. Thank you, Alisa.
Michael Alderlisten, can you ask your question?
Yes, I'm Michael Adelissen from the Amsterdam UMC. We have our own grondslag that we can spend. And I was wondering if some of these new criteria and aspects of your PPP allowance also then account for our internal calls.
Probably not, but that is up to the PPP contact persons and the internal call of the AMC.
That
will depend on their call.
Yeah. Okay. That's awesome. Thank you.
Jamal Adour, can you unmute yourself?
Yes. I have a question about the contribution of the company.
Yep.
I saw that it was 15, 30, 45, depending on the type of project.
Yep.
But is it the same for all the projects, because you described a different kind of routes. So the match call and the SHF project. So is it always the same, the contribution of companies, or that depends?
It can differ depending on the call, but for the match call, at least it's these, because it was another part of the match call, it's these percentages. So if you go either through some other organizations, their own call, it can change a little bit depending on what restrictions they want to give it. But for our match call, these are the percentages that you can use.
Oh, okay. That's only for the match call then. Thank you.
Elaine van der Valk, can you ask your question?
Yes, good morning. What I was wondering, you just said that private parties can receive some PPP allowance. And of course, it must be SMEs, and it must be a Dutch partner.
Yep.
The other thing that I was wondering about, as I understood it correct, is it correct that a foreign knowledge institute can also receive PPP allowance?
Yeah, a foreign knowledge institute can also receive PPP allowance. Exactly.
Yes, so that's the only exception for foreign. Yeah. Okay. Thank you, that was it.
Samuel, can you ask your question?
Hello everyone, Mohammed Samhiel. I'm a startup founder from India, and we are trying to work with Dutch healthcare companies to come up with like a feasibility study for the device developed. And we have a problem trying to understand as you've mentioned here, the Health Innovation Netherlands to do the CE marking and the feasibilities. So there's a question about intellectual property and how does the Health Holland look at it? What is the ideal situation that you would look for?
I'm not really following what your question entails. So you're saying what's the best ideal IP situation that we're looking for?
Yeah, so you have an example, a UMC, which will be doing, for example, the feasibility studies and the development together. Mm-hmm. On the new device that can work in, say, the European market and the global market. So what the technology, let's say the IP was developed in India, and mm-hmm. now we have to combine it with something new here in the Netherlands and bring it into a global standard and also do the CE marking, which yep. is applicable globally.
Yep.
So in this situation, since we are involving a UMC, but the technology came from a company which is situated abroad, but we are going to move in the future to the Netherlands and set up here.
Yeah.
What would be the problem from the Health Holland side, or what would be the ideal side?
Yeah, so there's not really a problem though, because the you can have your own IP IP regulations. No, not regulations. Afspraken. Afspraken. Yeah, appointment. Wait. So these different appointments that you made, they're all written down in a consortium agreement, and this has to follow some regulation that is set up by the Dutch government. And it has to, for us, the only restriction is that it has to follow this specific regulation. If you're interested, I can send you a document. It's a very legal document though, but if you're interested, you can send us an email and I can send it to you. But it has to follow those restrictions for the least. But you can, generate your own IP, and then it's still your IP, right? This is not restricted right there over there. But if you want more information on this, you can. I would urge you to send you an email as well, because I can help you a little bit more in detail about your situation.
Yeah, thank you.
Martin, you can unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yes, I was wondering if there is a maximum in amount of PPP use in one project?
Yeah, so that's only depending on the type of research. So only the 75% or the 50% or 25% or in case of fundamental, industrial or experimental development. Okay. Oh, and of course, by the available amount of reserved PPP allowance that you get from either from the grondslag, from your organization, or if it's the other, if you generate it yourself, then it's 30% of the cash contribution.
So in that case, if it's 300K, then you can use the full 300K in one project.
If you have 300K available of the PPP allowance, you can use it for one project. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks.
Willem, you can ask your question.
I don't hear anything.
Sorry, Willem, we can't hear you.
beginner's mistake. I have a question about the policy framework for the school. So a few years ago, there were only, let's say, the 10 LSH roadmaps, then the KIA came. The key of the technologies, technologies were added. Now also there are questions about working together, maybe in the future with the other PPPs. So there's a lot of framework there. And so what's most important to connect to? Is that the KIA? Because if we have to check all the boxes, and it's pretty difficult maybe, and also distracting maybe from the project and the KIA and the mission there.
Yeah, I understand your concern. However, this is the strategy that we imply from Health Holland to get the whole field in this same direction. We do implore you to carefully select one of the, parts and go a little bit more in depth on what this entails for your project. But the most important ones are either the missions, yes, and the how your project aligns with the KIA, and the key technologies and methodologies, because these are the first implementations of our strategies into the match call procedure. So I do understand that it's a bit much, but we have to make this shift towards this mission-driven innovation also in the match call procedure eventually.
But the LSH roadmaps, have they become less important for the school than the KIA?
That's in the match call application procedure. Those are just checkboxes. And everything that's more important, there's an open question. Then you have to write how do you see that this fits within these challenges.
Okay, clear. Thank you.
Yep.
Lena Beinen, you can ask your question now.
Thank you. It might not be good for this actual setup webinar, but I had a question related to the delays that the current projects are having. Yep. Is there anything to be expected for that, or do you still have the advice ask for new or apply for new projects?
So if you have a current project that is being delayed right now, I would like to ask you to send us an email to the same email address, and then my colleagues will pick up on that and try to help you find a solution for your project.
Yep. Okay, thank you.
Are there any more questions?
Lena, I can comment to that. You can also contact me directly about your project.
Yes, thank you, Andrea. I will do that.
So if there are no more questions, then I would like everyone to thank you for your attention. And you can find our contact details here if you're still looking for those. And I would wish you all a very nice day.